Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Scotia iTrade webinar. Today, we're talking all about trading options in your RRSP and tax-free savings accounts. Options are and do involve significantly more risk, and they're not suitable for all investors. And today, our presenter is Jason Ayres. He is a Montreal Exchange instructor. So with that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to pass it over to Jason, who will take us through the rest of the presentation.
Okay. Well, hi there. My name is Jason Ayres. I'm an options instructor for the Montreal Exchange. And in this presentation, we're going to discuss how you can trade options in your tax-free savings account and your RRSP. Now, as always, in an effort to satisfy the compliance and legal departments, I'll give you a couple of seconds to review the disclaimer slides. And remember that the information presented here is for educational purposes only. So be sure that you understand the risks associated with the strategies that we're about to discuss here today before you actually implement them in your live investment accounts. Now, as per the agenda, we're going to first review the different objectives and considerations typically associated with managing your investments within a registered account. We're going to talk about the eligible option strategies that you have available to you to help meet those objectives. We're also going to take a quick review of the basics. So for those of you that are just learning the options market, we're going to make sure that you have a bit of a background before we move forward. And then we're going to talk about the different strategies that are in fact permissible within your RRSPs, TFSAs, RESPs, and so on. So when it comes to objectives and considerations, quite often an investor will focus a little differently depending upon their looking to accomplish for their investment accounts or within their investment accounts. You know, one of the reasons, of course, that you want to be managing your RSP effectively is to ensure a comfortable retirement. You're also looking, obviously, to prevent drawdowns as much as possible. You want to focus on conceivably compounding your growth, as well as saving for your kids' education. So there's lots of different reasons why one would look to, you know, manage their registered accounts more effectively. And what we can do once we have those objectives sorted out is look at the options market in a way that will help us meet those objectives more effectively. So some of the strategies that we can in fact utilize are we can buy calls instead of buying stocks or exchange traded funds. So that's where we're going to use call options as a stock or ETF replacement strategy. We can in fact buy calls to secure the future purchase price of shares of a company we want to own or hold, or those of an exchange traded fund that we want to hold in our portfolio. We could generate cash flow and mitigate volatility through the utilization of the covered call strategy. We could also purchase put options instead of short selling. Now, important consideration, you can't short sell stocks within your registered accounts, but you can buy put options as a bearish strategy or a short stock replacement strategy. And of course, we can utilize put options as an effective way to hedge market risk on stocks and ETFs that we hold within our portfolio. So as I mentioned, we want to take a look at some of the key characteristics of the options market just to make sure that everybody's caught up to speed. So we're going to look at the rights and obligations associated with buying and selling calls and puts. And we're also going to look at the contract specifications as well before we get into looking at the actual strategies. So remember that there are two sides to every trade in the options market. And one of the unique considerations about utilizing options within your registered accounts or otherwise is the fact that you could be in fact, one or the other, or in certain circumstances, you could be both. And so the call buyer, remember, pays a premium and secures a right. And that right is to purchase 100 shares of the underlying security. And that premium that the call buyer pays is actually paid to the call seller, or we often refer to that side of the trade as the call writer. And they are in fact collecting a premium and taking on an obligation. And that obligation is in fact to deliver 100 shares for each contract sold on the underlying security. Okay, so the strategies that we're going to be talking about here in this particular presentation, we're going to be looking at utilizing call options as a stock replacement strategy, in which case we're going to be the call buyer. And we're also going to be looking at utilizing call options to help generate cash flow within our portfolio, in which case we're going to be taking on the position as the call seller or the call writer. So it's very important that you understand the difference between the two sides of the transaction and the different risk considerations and obligations associated with both as well, once again, before you start utilizing the strategies within your live portfolios. Now, as you'll recall, there are put options that we can utilize as well to help meet certain objectives. And once again, there are two sides that you can actually be on depending upon what you are looking to accomplish. Now, I will reinforce the fact that you can only be the put buyer within your registered accounts, but it is important to understand that there is another side to that transaction. So as a put buyer, you're going to pay a premium, you're going to secure the right, and the right isn't, or you're going to secure a right, and the right is to sell 100 shares for each contract purchased of the underlying security. So what we need to understand with this particular position is that as the value of the underlying shares drop, the put value will increase. And so this is where we can utilize that put as a means of participating in a bearish opportunity. So if we think a stock or an ETF is going to go down, rather than short selling the shares of the underlying security, which is not permissible in a registered account, we can buy a put option, which is permissible in a registered account. And as those shares drop in value, the put option will increase in value, and ultimately we will be able to close that position out profitably. Now, the other way that we can use that is as a hedge. So you may hold companies or exchange traded funds within your registered accounts, and you've been holding them for quite some time, and you really feel that there's longer term opportunity still, but you might want to manage some shorter term risk. So what you can do is, while you're holding the underlying shares, you can buy that put option. And we often refer to that as a married put. So you own the stock or you own the ETF, and you're going to buy a put option, and that put option is going to be married to the stock position. Just another way to look at the strategy. And what happens is, as the underlying shares drop in value, the put option will increase in value, ideally offsetting a significant portion of that downside, and really just giving you some time to consider whether or not you want to continue to hold the position or whether you want to readjust the position. But it really allows you to step back, not panic, recognizing that because you purchased that put option, you have secured the right to sell those shares at a specific price, no matter how low they go. Now, on the other side of that transaction is the put option seller or the put option writer. Now, there will be other presentations that will talk about this strategy from a cash flow generation standpoint, but you can't sell puts within your registered account. But recognize that there still is somebody on the other side of that transaction as the put buyer, and that is, again, the put seller or the put writer. So they will collect the premium from the put buyer and take on an obligation to buy the underlying shares at the strike price written. And that obligation is valid until the expiration date of the option contract. Now, again, we're going to talk a little bit more about this, the put buying strategy, as we move forward through the presentation, but really just wanted to give you a bit of a background as to the, the both sides of the transactions, and, you know, that of being a call buyer versus a call writer and being a put buyer versus a put writer. Now, remember that one contract, whether it's a call or a put option, represents 100 shares of the underlying security. So when we're looking at a options chain, which is how options prices are presented in the different contracts and expiration dates and strike prices are presented to investors, you'll recognize that the price is listed on a per share basis. So with the contract multiplier being 100, if you're looking at an option price listed as $1.25, well, you simply multiply that premium by 100, and the cost of that contract or the premium that you'll collect if you're the call option writer is going to be $125. If it's listed at 35 cents per share times 100 unit multiplier, it's $35. If it's $13.20 per share based on a 100 unit contract or multiplier, then the value of that contract is $1,320. So one of the really interesting things about the options market is just the flexibility in selecting both the price at which the rights and obligations are associated, as well as the duration of the option contract and when it expires. And so that really allows us to create some interesting positions and make adjustments in our positions according to what it is that we're looking to accomplish and the time frame during which we're expecting things to happen. So remember that for a call option, the strike price that we're looking at is the price at which the shares can be purchased. So as the call option buyer, we are looking at the strike price as the price at which we are able to purchase the shares. As a call option writer, we're looking at the strike price as the price at which we will have to deliver the shares if the underlying security happens to be trading at or above that particular price. For the put option buyer, the strike price represents the price at which the shares can be sold. So remember, if you're using a put option as protection, the strike price that you have purchased is the price at which you are able to sell those underlying shares, regardless of how low they're trading within the duration of that option contract's existence. Now, what that means for the put option buyer is, in fact, that is the price at which you have to buy the underlying shares. And again, that actually comes into play when we're looking at utilizing put writing as an income generation strategy in a non-registered account. There's some really neat strategies that you can build around that as well. The expiration date, it is essentially the date at which the option contracts, rights, and obligations are valid until. So remember that all options expire, and we actually get to choose the expiration date based on our contract selection process. So we have to make sure that we are taking that into consideration when we are building our strategies, that these contracts have an end date, they do have an expiration date, and we want to make sure that we are, you know, for the option buyer, we want to make sure that we're giving ourselves enough time for our expected move within the underlying to take place. And if we're the option writer, again, recognize that our obligation to deliver those underlying shares are valid until the expiration date or until, of course, we close the position out, which we can do at any point in time that we feel it's appropriate to do so. The other thing that I'll just mention here is that there are weekly options available on most active option classes. So there's some real interesting strategies that you can consider around that, generating weekly cash flow on, utilizing the covered call strategy within your portfolio, within your registered portfolios, or, you know, looking at buying some short-term protection if you're holding a stock that might have an earnings report within a week, you know, rather than paying a whole bunch of time value in buying a longer dated contract, you could essentially hedge out your risk around a certain event driven consideration, which may only be, you know, a requirement for a week. So another sort of one of the ways that you might rationalize your expiration date selection is just, again, why are you looking to use the option, and, you know, for how long do you think you'll need to have that position in place? Again, remember, you can close the positions out at any time. That means you can sell the option contracts back to the market if you're the buyer, and you could buy to close if you're the seller at any point before expiration. All right, so let's take a look at buying a call option in a registered account. So why would we buy a call option instead of buying the underlying stock? Well, it's an opportunity for us to leverage our capital. And what that means is, you know, if you're in a non-registered account, you might have a margin account, which allows you to essentially, you know, buy more shares of a position than you in fact have cash. So it just allows you to, you know, make your cash go a longer way, you know, how you allocate it to the market. And leverage can be a double-edged sword. So it allows you to enhance your returns, but it also increases your risk. So we can actually look at utilizing a call option as a way to leverage our capital. But the benefit is that we have a limited risk exposure. So we can leverage our cash by participating in an opportunity with less capital. But because we're buying a call option and we're only paying a certain premium per share for that call option, we have defined our risk, which means we can't lose more than the premium paid. Now, that being said, we do run the risk of losing 100% of that premium, because if, you know, the underlying security doesn't move as anticipated and we don't manage the position accordingly, then that option contract may expire worthless. And although our risk was limited, that capital is still all gone. So a really important consideration as you're you know, looking at implementing the strategy is, yes, you can leverage your capital with a limited risk, but your maximum risk is 100% of the premium that you've paid. And I'm going to illustrate that here in a moment. So let's take a look at two investors. We've got two investors that are both bullish. We're going to look at stock ABC, and the share price is $45. And both investors have a target price of $55 per share over the next 3 months. So there's two ways that we can actually participate in an opportunity like this. One is buy the stock. So the one bullish investor can buy 1,000 shares and pay $45 per share, in which case they're paying out $45,000. Now, again, important to remember that if you're doing this within your registered accounts, there's no way to leverage that. So you need to put up 100% of that cash in order to buy those 1,000 shares. Now, the other alternative is you could go to the options market, and within that same time frame, you could look at a 3 month 46 strike call option. So what does that mean? Well, basically that means that you have the right to buy shares of ABC at $46, no matter how high they trade, and that right is valid for the next 3 months. Now, the price of that option contract is listed at $3, which means you're going to pay $3 per share for that right. So you can see already the difference between buying the stock and buying the option, in that the stock purchaser is going to put up $45 per share, while the call option purchaser is going to put $3 up per share. Now, in order to acquire the equivalent exposure, or in order to create the same exposure as the 1,000 shares, the call option purchaser is going to buy 10 contracts, because remember, each contract represents 100 shares of the underlying security. So 10 contracts times 100 shares gives you the right to buy 1,000 shares, in this case at $46, over the next 3 months. Now, that is going to cost $3,000. Remember, $3 per share times 100 shares per contract times 10 contracts gives you $3,000. So when we compare the two here, we want to consider what if the shares drop in value? So what's the risk? So as the stock investor, if they're holding 1,000 shares and they've paid $45 per share, they put up $45,000, their risk is undefined. And in fact, they actually have a max loss of $45,000, because if they do nothing and the shares completely tank and ultimately go bankrupt, well, that's it. You've lost that entire amount. Now, if the shares go up in value and they happen to hit the target, well, the investor's up 10 bucks. If we compare that position to the call option buyer, once again, 10 contracts, 3 month expiration, 46 strike calls, they paid $3 per share with a cost of $3,000 in total, and they have a limited and identifiable risk of $3 per share. Now, remember, as I mentioned in the earlier slide, that the max loss is 100%. So if the shares of ABC drop and are trading below the 46 strike call on expiration, the call option buyer risks the $3,000. They'll lose that $3,000 or 100% of the premium that they've paid. Okay, so that's something that you always have to take into consideration. Now, if the shares go up in value and hit that $55 target before expiration, well, the call investor is actually up $6. So up less than the actual stock investor. But what you want to recognize is that while the stock investor has a 22% return on their risk, which is actually a really great return, the call investor has actually returned 200% on their risk. So this is where that opportunity to leverage one's capital with a limited risk exposure comes into play. Now, again, the difference between the two, and I think a really important consideration, is the stock investor can hold that position indefinitely. So let's say over the next 3 months, the shares do nothing and they end up closing, you know, below or at the $45 range. Well, they can continue to hold. Whereas the call investor, unfortunately, the options will expire worthless if the shares are trading below the 46 strike, and they will have to incur or realize that total loss. So the stock investor can be much more passive. They can hold on to the position for as long as the stock stays in business or the company stays in business, whereas the call investor has to recognize that they have a day of reckoning, so to speak, where the options will expire if the shares have not moved in their favor. And this is why, again, I always reinforce the importance of making sure that you allocate sufficient enough time to allow the position to, you know, take place. So even though you think the stock, for example, or ETF may move, you know, significantly within a 1 week or 1 month period, it typically makes sense to err on the side of caution and give yourself a little bit more time for the move to take place, with the recognition that you can close your option position out at any point in time during the life cycle of the contract, either to lock in profits or to manage your risk. Okay, so we've talked about buying a call option as a long or bullish stock replacement strategy. Let's now look at buying a put option as a bearish stock replacement strategy. So remember, again, I mentioned that short selling is not permitted in registered accounts. So you really don't have all that much choice if you are bearish on a company and you want to participate on the downside. So why we might buy the put option instead of shorting the stock? Well, the first choice is evident. You can't short sell in a registered account. But same as with the call option, you have an opportunity to participate with less capital because you're going to put up a small percentage of the share value by paying out the put premium. And your maximum risk is the premium that you pay. So you've limited your risk to the capital outlay, which is, again, calculated based on, you know, the cost of the contract, the premium, times the 100 unit multiplier, times the number of contracts that you're looking to participate with. So if we take a look at a bearish example, once again, we've got two investors, both bearish. The stock is XYZ and the share price is $42, and both have a downside target of $37 per share and a time horizon of over 3 months. Now, remember, you can't short sell the stock within a registered account. So this is really just for illustrative purposes. So if one were to look at short selling the shares of a stock that they were bearish on, you could short 1,000 shares of, in this case, XYZ at $42 and collect $42,000. Now, remember, the strategy behind short selling, if you're not familiar with it, is we're going to sell the shares to somebody else and collect the cash with the expectation that the shares are going to drop in value and we'll be able to close the position by returning less cash to the market. So we would sell to open a short position, 1,000 shares times 42. We would collect $42,000. And if the shares drop, let's say to 40, then we would buy to cover at 40 and collect the difference or keep the difference, which would be, in this example, I'm referencing $2,000, okay? The risk, of course, is if the shares skyrocket where you collected $42 per share, you would have to buy to cover at a higher price, 43, 45, 50, wherever those shares go, you've got to cover to limit and cut your losses. Now, an alternative to doing that, and of course, the only way you can do that within your registered accounts, is you could go to the options market, you could look at the available contracts and identify a 3-month 42 strike put option that is trading at $2.20. Now, to create the same short exposure as the stock example, you would buy 10 put contracts. And again, based on that multiplier, 10 or 100 times the premium times the number of contracts, you would take 100 times $2.20 times 10 contracts, and you would pay out $2,200. So again, in comparing the two, we look at the stock investor who's short 1,000 shares, has put up $42,000, or basically collected $42,000 into their account, and they have an undefined risk. So this is truly an undefined risk because, you know, where the long stock investor has a defined risk of zero, in other words, if the shares drop to zero, they can't drop any further. If somebody has short sold the shares, there's no telling how high those shares could go over a time period. And so it truly is an undefined risk. Now, the opportunity, of course, is if the shares drop in value, where the investor collected $42 per share, they can buy to cover at 37 and keep the $5 difference. So in this case, when you multiply that by the 1,000 shares, that investor has made, once they've closed the position, $5,000. Now, the put buyer, once again, 10 contracts, 3-month expiration, 42 strikes. So they have purchased the right, but not the obligation to short XYZ at $42 for the next 3 months. As the shares drop in value, right, the value to sell those shares at 42 becomes more attractive. It increases. So this investor paid $2.20 per contract, again, times 100, which is the multiplier, times 10 contracts. So this investor has put up $2,200 in order to participate. Again, comparative to the short seller who's put up or has an obligation of $42,000. And if the shares go up in value in the case of the put buyer, the risk is in fact limited to the premium paid. Now, that's still a risk of 100% of the premium, which in this case, under this example, is $2,200. But again, recognize that the stock investor, their risk is undefined. So if the shares actually jump $5, well, the stock investor is out $5 per share, or in this case, $5,000, whereas the put investor, if the shares jump $5, their maximum risk is $2.20 per share, or $2,200. It's still a 100% risk. And again, what you have to recognize is that where the short seller can hold the position as long as they can maintain their margin requirements within a non-registered account, the put buyer has a duration, has a time frame in which they have to be right. And if the shares don't drop below or haven't dropped below the strike price purchased, well, then those options will expire worthless and the investor will incur the 100% loss of the net capital allocated to the trade. All right, so on the positive side of it, though, of course, is if the shares do drop, then the investor or the put buyer will make the difference between the strike price and the settlement value, which in this case, we're using $37 as an example, which is $5 less the $2.20 premium paid, leaving $2.80 per contract or $2,800 for this position. Difference being, of course, that the short seller has made 12% return on their risk with an unidentified or undefined risk exposure, whereas the put buyer has a 127% return on the risk with a defined risk exposure if they happen to be on the wrong side of the position. Okay, so what we've just looked at are a couple of ways that you can trade a directional bias within your RRSPs or TFSAs. So it's a way that you can participate in a bullish opportunity, you know, by a call option, limited and identifiable risk exposure, ideally participate in the upside move of a stock. And then we looked at buying a put option, and it was a way that you could participate in the downside move of the stock. So these are really great ways that you can put up a small amount of capital to take advantage of an opportunity with a limited and identifiable risk exposure. But of course, many investors are really looking at ways that they can enhance cash flow within their portfolio. So of course, there's, you know, your traditional approach, which is, you know, you could hold bonds or preferred shares, you could collect dividends, you can collect interest. You know, those are the traditional ways by which you can generate cash flow within a portfolio. And those are all ways that you would look to continue to do. However, when you have an understanding of the options market, the other thing that you can do is you could implement a covered call strategy as well. So while you're generating cash flow through the more traditional means, you could also look at utilizing the covered call strategy as a way to enhance that cash flow. So the strategy works such that you buy or already own the underlying shares of your favorite stock, and that could be a dividend paying stock. And so while you're benefiting from, you know, the collecting dividends and or the modest upside of the stock, you sell a call and get paid a premium for taking on the obligation to sell the shares at a specific price. And that obligation is valid for a specific period of time. Now, what's great about this approach is that you can decide what price you are willing to sell the shares at. So if you feel that there's more upside on the stock and you want to try to generate some additional capital gains, well, you can sell a further out of the money call option, collect less premium, but benefit from additional capital gains. You can also collect more premium by selling longer dated options versus shorter dated options. So we'll talk about these considerations as we move forward. But the idea here is that you're looking to generate cash flow while you're holding the underlying security. So remember again that there's two sides to every transaction. So we just finished looking at the call option buyer who is in fact paying a premium. But on the other side of that is the option seller who's collecting the premium. So when you're stepping back and you're saying, well, I wonder when I buy a call option, who the heck would actually be interested in selling that to me? Well, it's conceivably somebody who has a different set of objectives. The call option buyer's objective is capital appreciation, you know, limited risk, and looking at taking advantage of the upside opportunity in a stock, whereas the option seller is somebody that says, no, you know what? What's more important to me is generating cash flow. I need to generate cash flow. I want to hold the stock. I love the company. It's paying me great dividends, but I also want to enhance the cash flow on the position as well. So that's the beautiful aspect of the market, is that you have all these different investors coming together with different objectives and buying and selling these contracts for all sorts of different reasons. And what's right for the buyer is actually also right for the seller. So why would you look to do this? Well, you get to create static income upfront, right? So the idea is that on a month-to-month or even week-to-week basis, you can create cash flow. It provides some added protection by reducing your cost base. So, you know, every quarter, or every 50 cents, every dollar that you collect against the shares that you hold, in fact, helps lower your cost basis. And that ultimately helps mitigate the volatility of your portfolio. And you really don't necessarily need the investment to increase in value to generate profit. So in a market that is trending sideways, this becomes a really interesting consideration to implement. So let's look at the basics behind this strategy. So typically the covered call tends to be held until expiration. Now you can close it early at a cost. What I mean by that is that if you own the stock and you sold the call option and before it expires, you think, well, you know what? The stock has done nothing. The call option has lost a lot of value. Why don't I just buy it back for less than what I paid for it? So it's the same principle as short selling stock. You sell the call for a higher price, you look for it to expire or drop significantly in value to close it, and then you subsequently generate the profit or the return on the position. But if you hold until expiration, which I mentioned is what typically happens, one of two things will happen. Either the option is exercised and you are assigned to deliver the shares at the strike price written, or the option expires, in which case you continue to hold the stock and collect the premium, and you could turn around and sell a contract for, you know, the next month or the next week or whatever the strategy is that you're doing, that you're implementing. All right, so let's take a look at a quick example here. So we have an investor that is looking to own shares of a company at $22. So they're going to buy 1,000 shares. They're going to put up $22,000. And again, this could be, you know, a company that's paying a dividend or not, as long as it's options eligible. And you're going to, or this investor is going to then go to the options market. And with the stock trading at $22, they're going to see that there's a 3-month 23 strike call trading for 40 cents. Now, what this means is that if this investor sells this 3-month call option, what they're doing is they're going to get paid 40 cents per share to deliver those shares at $23 at any point in time within the next 3 months. Now, selling 10 contracts means that this investor is going to generate $400 over that time frame. And again, we calculate that out just as we always have been. 40 cents per share times a 100 unit multiplier times 10 contracts means that we're collecting $400. So again, investor sells 10 calls, collects $400 for the obligation to sell the 1,000 shares over the next 3 months at $23. Now, that actually represents about a 1.85% return over the period, or a 7.8% return annualized. What we need to recognize with this position is that as long as that written call option is in place, the investor does not have the opportunity to participate in the capital gains over the strike price. So what you're in fact doing when you sell the call option is you participate up to the strike price, and then you give somebody, and you've sold somebody else the right to participate on any returns above the strike price, right? So you have to be comfortable with capping that upside. And you can make adjustments. So again, you can decide that, well, you know, I think over the next 3 months, the stock's going to go to 25. Well, instead of selling the 23 strike, you sell the 25. Maybe you collect 20 cents instead of 40 cents, but you still have that upside to benefit from if the shares happen to move in that direction. So generally speaking, the investor who is more focused on cash flow and mitigating volatility will tend to write at the money or close to the money calls. So stocks at 22, and they may write a 22 strike call or a 22.50 or a 23. An investor who is looking more at taking advantage of the upside will ultimately look at, again, selling a 24 strike, 25 strike, or what have you, collecting less return on the option right, but ultimately benefiting from the upside opportunity on the underlying shares. So again, this just reinforces the consideration for strike price selection. So you can sell an in-the-money call. Now, a lot of people say, well, why the heck would I want to do that? Well, you're going to get the highest premium when you go in the money. And that's because you're actually selling intrinsic value, which is reviewed in our options fundamentals presentation. So that intrinsic value, in fact, acts as a downside buffer should the stock drop against you. But the time component of that option contract will still yield a modest return. So why you would look to do an in-the-money call right is you're looking more to be defensive and manage the downside more effectively than you are necessarily looking to collect the premium. The at-the-money call right gives you the greatest time value and therefore the greatest cash flow. So the investor who's really looking at just consistently collecting, you know, cash and income and enhancing yields on a week to week, month to month basis, is typically going to look to sell the at the money call options. Now, the investor who wants to benefit from potential upside of the stock is going to sell an out of the money call option. You're going to collect lower premium, you're going to get less cash flow, but it leaves upside for the stock. Now, the other consideration here for this strategy, which I think is really interesting, is also as a way to get paid to take profits. So for example, you may buy a company because you expect it's going to go up, you know, over the next couple of months. And let's say it goes up, hits your target, you know, maybe you've got a nice 5% return or 7% or what have you. You could then sell a call option against the position and get paid to take profits. So buy the stock, ride the trend to the upside, recognize that the stock may be turning around, and you could sell an at the money or even slightly in the money call option and ultimately get paid to take profits. You can do that on a portion of your position. So if you want to sell a third, just sell a call at or in the money on a third of the position. If you want to sell it all, just cover the entire position. But that's what's really interesting about this strategy. You've got so much flexibility to adapt to your objectives and to the market conditions. Now, depending upon, again, what your objectives are, you're going to also have to make a decision on what expiration month to choose. So when we refer to front month, to the front month, we're referring to the month that we're in now. So the front month or even weekly option expiration dates generates a higher annualized cash flow, but it's more transactional. So if you're sensitive to paying a commission every time you transact a trade, well, you want to recognize that, you know, you may want to go a little bit of a longer time frame and duration. Now, you know, it tends to be a little bit more cost effective if you're being transactional on a larger portfolio, because of course you're collecting more premium. So that's something that you want to consider as well. So how active you are is going to be dependent upon really the size of your portfolio. So if you're concerned about, you know, the implications of being a little bit more transactional and the impact of commissions, then you could go to the further out strike prices, or sorry, expiration months. That's going to give you more upfront premium, right? So you're actually going to collect a little bit more upfront, which gives you more premium as a short-term buffer to help mitigate some short-term volatility. And it's also less transactional. So you're not going to have to reestablish the position on a week-to-week or month-to-month basis necessarily. And you also don't run the risk of being assigned on a regular basis either, on a shorter time frame. And I say run the risk. It's not really a risk. If you get assigned early on a position, it just simply means that you are recognizing your returns early on the position. What that means is the stock moved in your favor. Somebody wants to take the stock off your hands. They're willing to give up the premium that they've paid. So you get to keep that, you know, the premium. You lose the stock, but you ultimately can reestablish the position. And in fact, it's helped with your annualized rate of return. Really, at the end of the day, what you need to make sure that you do is just take some time to consider what you're trying to accomplish and select the approach that meets your objectives. So in general, we can look at this strategy from a couple of different perspectives when it comes to just establishing how to approach it. If you're somebody, once again, that is looking at capital gains, you're a little bit more of an active trader, then you could look at the short-term trading aspect of utilizing these this call option strategy, which means, you know, you could sell weekly options. You could, you know, you could buy the stock and sell an out of the money call and close out the position as soon as it hits a short-term target. All sorts of different considerations if you're prepared to be a little bit more active. You are going to be looking at this, conceivably be looking at this as a way to help enhance your retirement income, in which case, again, you're going to choose the appropriate strike price and expiration date to help accommodate that. Really, ultimately, by consistently selling these call option contracts against the underlying shares, you're trying to compound benefit from compounding growth. And the intention is that, you know, you can benefit from stock market style returns with less risk. So in other words, you know, by utilizing the covered call strategy, you're not necessarily looking at trying to beat the markets, but what you're trying to do is you're trying to, you know, keep up with the markets and but do it with less risk while generating that consistent cash flow on your portfolio. All right, so we're going to take a look now at utilizing puts as protection. So as we know, markets are cyclical, and we have our uptrends and we have our downtrends. And so we need to be able to adjust and adapt our approach according to where we're at within the market. So while a number of these strategies that we've just discussed, you know, the call option purchase and the covered call strategy are generally, you know, best applied for a market that's trending to the upside, from time to time, we want to consider the potential for the market to go down. And that's where buying a put option to trade a directional bias to the downside comes into play, or buying a put option for protection comes into play. And what's really interesting about, again, this approach is you could be implementing the covered call strategy on a regular basis on your favorite companies, generating the cash flow, collecting the dividends, and then all of a sudden you get into a period where you say, well, wait a second, I still want to keep running the covered call strategy, but maybe I should add some protection while I'm doing it. So you would simply buy or own the underlying shares and buy a put option to secure the right to sell the shares at a strike price that you're comfortable with selling them at. And so what this does for the period in which you're holding that put option is it defines your risk, right? And ensures that no matter what happens within that time frame, no matter how low those shares drop in value, you're not going to lose any more than the difference between what you paid for the stock and the strike price that you purchased alongside of the premium that you paid. In fact, the risk reward profile of the protective put is the same as the call option. You have a limited and identifiable risk exposure for the time frame at which the option contract is trading, so up until its expiration date. So let's take a look again at an example. We're going to look at a protective put on shares of ABC. So let's say we owned ABC at $42, and we're going to look to buy a three-month $42 strike put. So you'll see these numbers probably look familiar because we use the three-month 42 strike put at $2.20 as our bearish trade opportunity example. Now all we're looking to do is utilize that same put, but in the context of it being insurance on a stock position that we hold. So share purchase at $42, we're going to buy a $42 strike put valid for 3 months. We're going to pay $2.20 per share. Our risk is limited to the cost of the put up until expiration. So again, let's say we just own 100 shares in this case of the underlying stock. So we bought 100 shares, we paid $42. We put up $4,200 in capital. We're going to buy 1 3-month 42 strike put. It's going to cost us $220. So we are going to pay 5.23% premium for a guaranteed $42 sale price over the next 3 months. So what does this really mean? What this means is no matter how low the shares go within the next 3 months, the most that we can lose is 5.23%, right? So you know you can go to sleep at night and every night, and no matter how bad things are getting, that is your maximum risk. So let's assume that the shares drop from $42 down to $36.50. So as the investor, you're down $5.50. Well, the put option that the investor bought at $2.20 is now worth $6. And so the value of that option contract is going to be based on the difference between the share value and the strike price. So when we look at it from the perspective of the average investor who simply just held the shares independent of any protective strategy, they're actually down 13%, right? So the protective put, in the case of the protected investor, has reduced the risk by the cost of the premium. So the protected investor is down $2.20 per share, the cost of the premium, versus the $5.50 that the average investor would be down, or comparatively, they're only down 5.23% comparative to 13%. All right, so the idea is that the average investor had an unidentifiable risk, whereas the protected investor had a risk, but it was identifiable within the duration of the put option contract that they were holding. So what are some scenarios at expiration? Well, if you're holding that put option and the stock has dropped, as we've just demonstrated, you can actually sell the stock at the strike price. The option will expire worthless, and you simply give up the premium. So there's that $2.20 cost of insurance. The other consideration, if the stock has dropped as we've demonstrated, and you as the investor wish to keep the shares, is you can either roll the put option. So what that means is you buy back the one that's profitable, and then you simply purchase another one that's maybe at a lower strike price, so down where the stock's trading presently, and out another expiration date. So in this case, it's referred to as rolling down and out. But you could also just simply close the option before expiration and continue to hold the share. So you've profited on the option. You believe the shares have maybe found a support level, so you don't feel that protection is warranted any further, and you ultimately just continue to hold the shares, having been able to protect that position over that period of time with the put option. Now, if the shares don't go down in value, well, you can continue owning the stock. So the option expires, right? And the investor gives up the premium, but you still continue to own the stock because it did not drop in value, right? So some of the considerations here with the protective put is that if you're bullish on the stock, you could actually, in a period of market uncertainty, you could buy the shares, buy a protective put, and take a shot with a defined risk. So very similar to that of buying a call option. If the shares drop in value, you actually have an opportunity to reposition, because maybe it was just a short-term drop and the longer-term outlook is still positive. Well, you could simply reposition. So one of the ways that you can do that is you could continue to hold the underlying shares, sell the put option, use the profits from that put option to buy more shares of the underlying security at a lower price. So you're essentially using the gains on the put option to slightly dollar cost average your position if you feel that it's appropriate to do so. The main consideration here, I think, which is important because a lot of investors look at the idea of utilizing stop losses as a way to manage risk, is that a stop loss, you can be taken out of the position at any time. So if you happen to hold a position and the market is volatile one day and you've got a stop in place, that stock could drop, hit your stop, and you're out. The other consideration is that sometimes overnight, a stock will gap down. So what that means is, stock closes at $20 at the end of the day on a Tuesday, and subsequently earnings or some sort of other announcement comes out and it opens back up Wednesday morning, down at $15. And a stop loss is triggered at the market, which means you may have a 50-cent stop in place, but you're going to get out at what the market is willing to pay for those shares when it opens up that following day. So by utilizing the protective put, it trades independently. So you don't have to worry about getting stopped out when the market is volatile on a day-to-day basis. You can make the decision as to when you feel it's appropriate to get out, if and when that decision needs to be made. The other consideration is that you can use protective puts to lock in profits. So let's say that you've been, riding a nice trend on one of your favorite stocks for a long period of time, and you think that maybe the market's getting a little bit toppy, maybe the stock is hitting its targets, you could subsequently buy a put option, continue to hold the position if you feel there's further upside, but buy that put option to lock in the profits that you've generated less the premium that you've paid. Now, a couple of considerations. Continuously buying expensive put options will increase the position's break-even point. So in other words, you know, if you keep buying puts and you keep adding them to the cost basis of the stock position, it's going to take that much more of an upside move to offset the cost of your put options. And so you really want to use this strategy sparingly. I always look at it as kind of like a get out of jail free card. So, you know, you have the position in place and the shares sell off. You can consider what you want to do moving forward, get out of the position in its entirety, or, you know, make an adjustment. But if the shares continue to go down, you've got to step back and realize maybe it's just not a good investment to be in. So remember, that protective put, you're only going to put in place or add to the position if you feel that there is still further longer term upside for the position. At some point, you got to recognize that maybe you're in a bad investment. You got to cut the position and find somewhere else to invest your money. So on that note, what we want to recognize is that as an investor who looks to learn about the options market, you are opening yourself up to a lot of different alternatives compared to the traditional approach. You can buy call options as a long stock replacement strategy. You could buy put options as a short stock replacement strategy. In both cases, you have the ability to leverage your capital with a limited and identifiable risk exposure. You can reduce the volatility and risk within your portfolio by implementing protective put strategies, and even the covered call strategy through generating income will help mitigate volatility to a certain extent. You can also, again, use the covered call strategy to enhance income and cash flow beyond the traditional means. And again, finally, tying that back into my first point there, leveraging your capital with a defined risk. Okay, so again, thanks everybody for joining in, and we'll pass it back to home base.
Awesome, Jason. I appreciate that. And with that, what I want to do is I want to thank you for your time and good luck with trading.